right? Well, not exactly. Let's recap the final showdown. Walt comes to the neo-Nazi compound with an automated remote-controlled turret built into his trunk. He tackles Jesse to the ground, clicks the button, the trunk pops open, and a barrage of bullets kills almost all the neo-Nazis inside. But what we're most interested in is near the end of the attack, when Walt gets hit by... something. I mean, it's kind of hard to tell, honestly. All we really do is see him grunt. Now, we know from the opener of Season 5, Episode 1, that Walt purchased an M60 machine gun with 7.62mm NATO rounds. It's pretty heavy-duty machinery, as evidenced by the fact that it blasted through the side of the trunk and the wall of the neo-Nazi rec room like it was nothing. But let's look at the setup here. It's highly unlikely that Walt was actually hit by one of these bullets. First, Walt is too low to the ground. Walter's hoopty of death is a fifth-generation Cadillac DeVille, which according to the manufacturer stands exactly 56.7 inches tall, or about 1.4 meters. If we take this photo of Walt standing outside the car and apply some basic algebra and pixel counting, we can conclude that the trunk is 40.5 inches off the ground, or slightly over 1 meter. The M60 shoots slightly lower than the exact height of the trunk, so let's just say it's an even 39 inches, about 1 meter, just to be safe. Considering that the average width of a human being is about 9.5 inches, or 24 centimeters, even if Walt and Jesse were planking on top of each other, toe to toe, forehead to forehead, they would still be far lower than the line of fire. I mean, you can even see the difference from the bullet holes in the wall compared to their relative position on the ground. So obviously it's not a direct bullet hit, maybe it's a ricochet. Seems like a solid possibility, except for one thing. According to my research, it seems that higher powered bullets like a 7.62mm NATO round tend not to ricochet. They usually either crush into the object they hit or break apart. Ricochets are much more common with low caliber ammo, such as a 22 or 177. The most likely culprit for injuring Walt, then, is either shrapnel or a broken piece of a bullet entering from Walter's side. Why the side? Well, because throughout the ensuing scenes, we get a pretty good glimpse at the front and back of Walt's jacket, and there simply aren't any holes, so the right side is the only option. Okay, so we have a piece of shrapnel entering Walt's love handle. Knowing this, let's look at our medical criteria. Number one, the location of the wound. We never actually get to see the wound itself, only the blood stain on the lower right side of his shirt, which is such a shame because I really love that shirt on Walt. Given the radius of the blood stain, we can only make an educated guess as to where the entrance wound is. The biggest risk associated with a bullet wound to the abdomen is hitting either the lower aorta or some of the major blood vessels. If such was the case, though, Walter would have keeled over and bled to death very quickly. But that's not what happens. Walter walks, talks, and even tells Lydia that he murdered her with relative grace for over 10 minutes. Now, you could potentially write off a lot of Walt's mobility as shock, but even shock can't keep you alive for 10 minutes if a vital organ's been hit in your body. No, given the location of blood on Walt's shirt, it's likely that the shrapnel got lodged somewhere in his large intestine. And believe it or not, this is actually good news. Quote, "The main concern with gunshot wounds that involve the intestines or stomach is not bleeding, but infections that result from spillage of the contents of those organs." End quote. In other words,
"I'm gonna wish you were dead, but it takes days to die from your wound."
A study conducted by the medical journal The Annals of Surgery looked at victims of gunshot wounds to the abdomen over a period of 5 years between 1983 and 1987. The survival rate among victims that had no vital organs hit was an astounding 88.3%. That's incredibly high. And with medical technology having only gotten more advanced over the last 30 years, Walt would have a real chance at survival. Which means we should move on to the second criteria, amount of blood lost. Now, blood loss is likely the factor that causes Walt to collapse onto the ground and stare blankly up at the ceiling. But the big question here is whether he died due to the blood loss or merely passed out. Well, let's take a look. Although we can't realistically measure the amount of blood that's dripped onto the ground or absorbed onto Walt's clothes, we can draw some encouraging conclusions due to the fact that there's no blood on the other side of his shirt, which means the bullet didn't go through him. Exit wounds leave a much bigger hole than entrance wounds, thereby leading the victim to bleed to death much faster. In other words, this fact buys Walt some valuable time. Now, one thing that I haven't brought up that I'm sure is on the tip of all your theorists' tongues is that Walt's lung cancer is back, thereby making his body more fragile and perhaps more sensitive to blood loss. But get ready to have your mind blown, because there's research to suggest the exact opposite, that his cancer would have increased his chances of survival. There's actually a significant amount of research that suggests that people with pancreatic pancreatic cancer, multiple myeloma, and most importantly for our purposes, lung cancer, are all more likely to form blood clots. According to Dr. Gene Connors at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, for reasons not quite known, the normal human body will keep a balance between pro-clotting and anti-clotting activity. Apparently, cancer skews that balance in terms of pro-clotting, increasing inflammation and compression of blood vessels, creating more coagulation and actually lessening internal bleeding. Long story short, there's actually a high probability that Walt's cancer is limiting the amount of blood he's losing in these crucial minutes. So we have not a full bullet, but a smaller piece of shrapnel entering Walt's body in an area with non-essential organs, Walt's slow tour about the compound showing that the injury is not really that critical, and a situation in which blood loss is slowed via only an entry wound, it being in the intestine, and Walt having cancer. That brings us to the final criteria of determining the likelihood of survival, speed at which the victim gets medical attention. If Walt were alone somewhere in the New Mexico desert, this would be an open and shut case. He would have bled out and died. But the final shot shows us a unit of police officers descending on him almost immediately after he collapses. Are they DEA? Albuquerque PD? If we zoom in on the arm patch, the shape and color definitely indicate that it's Albuquerque PD. According to code 02-11 of the Albuquerque Police Department Procedural Orders Manual, quote, department policy is to ensure that medical care is provided to arrested persons, intoxicated persons, when such care is needed, based on approved medical and legal procedures. So not only are the police obligated to give Walt medical attention, but let's not forget that the Walter White case is a national story. They want Walt to see trial. They want Walt to live so that he can confess to all the unsolved murders he's been involved with. It is in their best interest to keep him alive so that these cases can be concluded. Add to that the fact that it's reasonable to assume that there's a standard issue trauma kit in at least one of those cop cars, and most every police officer is trained to dress a gunshot wound, so Walt's bleeding would have been significantly reduced as soon as a minute after he collapsed. And if you're looking at this from a timeline standpoint, he literally just collapsed. We even see the police cars rushing past seconds before he falls to the ground. And here's a big piece of evidence for you. Why are the cops even there? Who called them? The pile of dead neo-Nazis certainly didn't. Walt and Jesse didn't do it. The most likely case is that someone nearby heard the M60 gunshots and called the cops. What that tells us is that although we're never given a real location for Jack's neo-Nazi day camp, it means we're close to civilization. Based on the length of that last scene, it took 10 minutes for the cops to arrive at the location. That also means that there's likely a hospital in that vicinity. So looking at all the pieces of evidence, considering the wound didn't hit any vital organs, was a smaller piece of shrapnel, didn't leave an exit wound, that clotting was increased due to cancer, and that help was on the scene immediately after his collapse, and Walt got medical attention somewhere in the realm of 20 minutes from the time he was shot, there's a high probability that Walt survives this last scene of Breaking Bad. But you don't have to believe me or all the research I did, just trust the creators of the show. If you look really, really closely at that final moment, you see the officer reach out and check for Walt's pulse, and then the scene cuts out before we get his reaction. We don't actually see the results of that test. Think this was a coincidence? Heck no. It was a purposefully done move by a creative team who thought through every last detail of every shot in this show. What seemed like a clear-cut and kinda cliched ending is actually open to interpretation. We just saw the easy, obvious answer, but by doing the research, you see that there's a lot more ambiguity to that final scene. And to that, I only have one thing to say.
Yes, science!
And before I sign off, if you